Looking to get into the luxury real estate market? Don't know who to talk to about it? Well, I got just the person. Michael Ferraro. We'll be interviewing him right now. Welcome to the show, everyone. I have Michael Ferraro here from Executive Premier Properties. He sells multi-million-dollar homes, so he's a lifestyle agent. He's originally from upstate New York. Hey, Michael, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, and welcome to the show, good sir.
So I'm Mike Ferraro, Executive Premier Properties and LLA, Leading Lifestyle Agency. Luxury lifestyle agent, all the taglines. I'm from upstate New York, a little town called New Paltz. And it's exit 18 off the thruway. And came from a family of all teachers and coaches. And I was had an athletic upbringing and background. And I ended up becoming an All-American swimmer at Southern Connecticut State University.
Oh, congratulations.
Oh, thanks. That was over 10 years ago. So that was a lifetime ago. But more, you know, that's where I was a sports kid, jock kind of guy, and exercise science degree. So I was going to be a phys ed teacher like my dad, and a swim coach. And I thought I wanted to coach the collegiate level or the Olympic level. And so I pretty much did that. I was a teacher and I was a swim coach for some top athletes for a while. And then, one thing led to another, and my life kind of shifted. And I talk about this on a couple other podcasts that I always had, was always one of those people that had this thing inside of them where I felt like I was doing what I love with coaching, but with the whole teaching thing, I always felt like I had this entrepreneurial part in front of me and a sales part in me, and I just always felt like I was out of place. It was weird. Everything would be okay. I would always have this feeling inside of me like something wasn't right. And meeting my wife and having our beautiful children and living where we were living, we were doing okay, but we didn't, you know, I just had this feeling inside me like there's something more that I wanted to do and wanted to give. So that is how it led me into the real estate world, and one thing led to another, and now I'm talking to you. So
great.
Yeah.
So we have a mutual coach, Bob Leffler. Tell us about how you met Bob and got into Fearless Agent.
Yeah, I worked with Bob in the beginning of trying to figure out my venture. I got in with Bob and Fearless Agent, and he was a great guy. Still is to this day. Still call him for, you know, if I need advice here and there for things. And yeah, he was a big part in me kind of really understanding the beginnings of prospecting. Me being who I am, since then I've kind of taken everything, you know, I got to the next level with a lot of things, and where I'm just kind of entrenched in some of the sciences of it and everything like that. But Bob was the initial person that I went to. I worked with a ton of other coaches, and he was one of the first people that it just broke it down pretty simple. And his method was very much for me. There wasn't a lot of fluff around Bob, as you know.
Right.
But he's a great guy.
He's straight to the point.
Straight to the point, and he helped me understand the basics around why certain things are said the way they're said, and I think that was the initial part that I needed into being able to build my career, because I built it in prospecting. And
right.
So yeah, Bob's a great guy. I have nothing but the best to say about him. So.
And from our communication talking, you kind of like advanced the expired script to work with multi-million-dollar properties. So tell us about that, how you got into the multi-million-dollar properties and how you're able to use Bob's script or a variation of his and your own to acquire those listings.
Well, the bottom line with the scripts and all that stuff is that they're great. It's a great tool, and Bob's 100% right with how he coaches it and what he's actually, the resources he's giving. I just, you know, I just took it and I went into the science of what we say, how we say, and I just got really in depth. So a lot of what I do sometimes is I talk about a lot of the sciences behind why some of these, you know, linguistic programming and verbal hypnosis.
Yeah, the NLP part of it.
some parts of that, but it's a lot more detailed. So in the ebooks that I kind of wrote, it was just a guide for, I had a lot of people asking these questions and I love to teach and coach. So I just took on that. Nothing with, I mean, separate from what Bob does. Bob has his own thing for illustration and it works and it's great. I just do something
right.
A little.
Your own style.
Yeah. And having
and
said
since
that,
you're in the, I'm sorry, since you're in the field, you could put into, you know, perspective, like, hey, this is what's working for me, you know, with your daily activities with your deals and prospecting.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, the reason why it became so apparent for me to really understand this stuff is because, yeah, I do high-end properties. And mm-hmm. I wanted to go in there, and I went into this business saying I was going to list multimillion-dollar property. I want to sell multimillion properties. Well, nothing about me is luxury. Nothing about me ever had any money in my family. It's not like we ever came from that. So
right.
The biggest misconception mentally for a lot of people is that how, if you've never come from it, how, if you don't know it, how are you going to be able to influence and persuade someone to trust you in dealing with those things? There's a belief that says that the high-end, the affluent people, they stick together and you can never break into them and we just don't want to work with them. And it wasn't right. That for me. I was saying that's not a reasonable answer, that's not good enough. So for me, I didn't have the money for mailers, or I didn't come up with that old school approach of like, I'm going to send mailers out to everybody and I'm going to do all that stuff. I came up with the one opportunity that I had, which was to use my time, and I had to have a higher skill level in order to be able to persuade and be able to help these people. Really, at the end of the day, it's how many people can you truly help? Because if you can't really sell their properties, if you can't really help them, you're just wasting everybody's time. So
right, exactly.
I really wanted to have the skill level and the ability to actually send this from start to finish. So using certain services and having the ability to actually understand how to actually help these people, I was able to prospect some higher end properties. Knock on wood, you know, have had some success with it, and want to continue that. And then when people ask me, I teach them or talk to them about how that was done, how I kind of, you know, modified certain things. And I want to say modified because, again, if, you know, this is a lot about Bob, and it's true though, but he teaches you a lot of the stuff that's very, very important basics, as do I, but then I just kind of take and run with a little bit more advanced stuff for certain people and for certain, this, so the types of stuff that I work on work for all levels. This is not, you have to be selling $5 to $29 million properties. This worked for $200,000 houses. It doesn't matter. It's how do you get the ability to be able to help these people? And you can't help them unless you get in contact with them. You can't go to their house for a listening presentation unless you understand what you need to be able to say, unless you need to be able to do that. So that's it. So
exactly.
I work that like that.
And also too, I really believe it's about mindset. Because if you go in there thinking that, oh, I can't list multi-million-dollar properties, of course you can't. If you go in there thinking, oh, I can list multi-million-dollar properties, of course you can. I know when we was talking, you told me how you got that first million-dollar listing. And I think that is so cool and down to earth. Give us a quick story about that, how you got your first million-dollar listing.
Well, before I even get into that, you're 100% right. It's the mindset thing. Like in my first ebook, we talk about mindset first and foremost, because at the end of the day, you're not going to be able to overcome the objections and just the hurdles of just this business if you don't have this mindset and understanding that's not all easy. It's a lot of hard work. And being able to work in the high-end mindset is, I think it's tough for a lot of people because they think like, no, I just can't do it. So if I said to you, do you have the ability to sell somebody's house for more than it's worth? And can you get more money for somebody than they could get any other way? And if you truly do not believe that or know, then you probably should not be prospecting, trying to get listings, which you can't really help them anyway, because you wouldn't be able
much to. Much less be in real estate.
Yeah. I mean, you have to understand that. So I think with understanding actually what your tools and systems are and actually how you actually can get somebody's house sold for more than anybody else, and then you actually know how that happens, you believe it 100%, be able to communicate that, it's like saying, I have this really important answer and I want to run outside right now and let everybody know that this is super important. I have this answer. You overcome that. I can't help them. What are they going to say? I can't work with multimillion-dollar properties. I have to sell my house is the same for $200,000, is for $2 million, is for $20 million. They have right. different, you know, the $20 million guy might need to sell his house because he's got five other ones or something like that. There's things do change, but the basic principle of having the ability and understanding that you know how to do it and that you can do it, that overcomes a lot. So we talk about that a lot in mindset, and it's so hard this business that without passion and that mindset, yeah, you are probably, and we talk about the why, your why is like your superpower. It is
right.
You will get beat down and you will stay there without your why, without the mindset to overcome this stuff. So my story on how I took my first $1 million listing, so to speak, is it was Miss America's house. And basically what happened was I kind of followed this person on social media, and it was a relationship that they had with another person as well. And it was kind of just want to offer up my services. Now, this is really before I had even truly got into prospecting. So right. I tell you that, I mean, this isn't a ton of that, but I prospected through just sending out a message basically to them, just, and also videoing myself and kind of just saying, hi, you know, this is me in front of whatever in this area that I was from, this area that I was doing open houses in, and love to invite you down. You have a red carpet if you ever want to come by. And it was just delete, delete, delete. I know they were deleting my deleting the messages. And then I just got a response one day basically from them that says, you know, we would be open to that. Would you want to meet with us? And so met with them. They were absolutely wonderful people. And the house sold in 9 days for over asking price. And I had both sides of the deal. And the owner of that, the person who ended up buying that house was a big owner of a restaurant chain that a lot of people know. And then one thing led to another. But I will tell you that that is not, that had nothing to do with any of the other listings that I've gotten, because it had all been through prospecting. Those were done in different parts of the state. So,
right.
It really,
that was your first one, correct?
That was my first listing, actually. That was my first real listing ever. I had worked with one other buyer, was a friend of mine. That was the only thing I ever sold. And then mm-hmm. I had like a transaction with, but my first listing was that one.
And I think, I want to put it in perspective so different agents can be like, blow up that mindset. Well, hey, I have to have a fancy car. I have to have $5,000 clothes or a suit or whatever. What? I hope I'm not putting you on the spot. But no. What kind of car you pulled up in to take that list?
Oh, man, when I came. Okay. So when I left that morning, we were living in a 1,000-square-foot condo townhouse in the inner city with bars on the back of my house, of my doors. And, we had no money. Christmas was like, you know, I couldn't afford a tree kind of thing. Like,
oh man, I remember those.
And I rolled up in my Honda Accord and I was so happy. I had this Honda Accord lease, of course. And I was like, I love that Honda Accord. There's nothing wrong with Honda Accords.
Right.
And I rolled up there and I can dress decent. Like I can afford like a dress shirt, some Express or something like that, which is fine. And I can tell people that you get to a point where there's the flash. And that's probably the number one overrated thing, is that people believe, especially people in high end, that you have to have flash, which is when you deal with people with wealth and things like that.
Right.
It's less flash than you think. Depends on what part of the country you're in. My part of the country, there's not a lot of flash. There's a lot of family money. There's a lot of wealth management money. There's a lot of hedge fund money. That's a different kind of money.
Old school money.
Yeah. I mean, you might have somebody come up in a drive up in a Subaru who's got more money than you can imagine. And they don't need to flaunt it. And that's not the point. I think a lot of times is at the end of the day, whether you're dealing with any type of size, buyer, seller, whatever, if you have the ability to convey that you are, you're somebody who can help them, I think that's one of the most important things. They will go.
If you can help them and solve their problems.
You can help them solve the problems and you're an authority figure and you come off as somebody who's that way. They will listen to you and they will take your advice and they will want to work with you, especially if they do feel like you can actually, you have the understanding to solve their problems.
And also to know the market, right? because some of these homeowners know the market better than some of these realtors.
Well, yeah. Yes and no. I mean, knowing the market. So a lot of times the problem is there's so much about the market out there. You know, somebody can go right now on Zillow and name a town, right? Mm-hmm. Look on Zillow and probably know a ton of stuff about that town. Now, I might not know anything about that town. Now, are they right. better suited to sell that property than I am?
Mm-hmm.
So they have information that I can simply get. The difference is, what are you actually doing with that information? You know, what kind of expertise do you have with days on market inventory? What are you doing with list of sale price ratios, price per square foot? What are you doing with your marketing that's going to then be able to increase the value of the home, whether perception or mass marketing, target marketing, or prospecting? So what right. are you actually doing? But then even more importantly than that, how are you able to convey that to your client or your prospective client? That you show them that you care, okay, that you're a trusted advisor on this, and that you're an authority figure here. How do you, what words do you say, and how do you say it, and how are you doing this? Because I can tell you, I went into some people's houses that have a lot of money, and are really well-known and advisors to some of the best people, especially in the financial world. And I can, I go in there, and I do not have the financial mindset as far as some of these guys. I don't have the bank accounts of some of these guys. I haven't been on earth sometimes double the amount of time I have, you know? So
right.
How do you take that and how do you communicate that you do know what you're talking about? That's one thing, but then also communicate that you actually can help them. You do have right. this sauce and the ability to help them so much that they trust you. And I think of a lot of it, there's certain positions in this world that are jobs that people need, right? A doctor is one of them. We go to doctors, we trust doctors, most people do. And when they're really sick, sometimes they don't have a choice. They have to, whether they don't like doctors or not, they have to trust a doctor. So doctors go through years of schooling and they have all of this intensive test
that knowledge. They
themselves and knowledge, right? Okay, so then you go and you have to sit there and your doctor's going to talk to you and you don't always agree with what the doctor says. Sometimes you question their prognosis. But at the end of the day, when something needs to get done, they are the ones that get it done for you. And at the end of the day,
exactly.
sometimes a personality doesn't always match with what you want them to be, but you are always going to trust them because they are the authority figure. There's ingrained in us that those are the authority figures. When we look at real estate agents, we look at them more from the sales component because a lot of us don't have the ability to communicate that we do know what we're talking about and we can help them. So right. they don't perceive it as an authority figure who can help them. Look at the sales guy. And when you're really high end, they deal with financial advisors, they deal with professionals in every single aspect. So you have to come off that way. It's less sometimes about the how you dress or the cars you drive, but more about the knowledge. You
know,
how you can right. communicate that and how you're actually able to help them. And you have to show them. These are a lot of analytical people as well, where you have to actually show them how this works.
Right.
So yeah, that's not to get off topic, but being able to.
No, hey, that's fine. And also too, I have one of my questions here. Like some agents think, now, is it once you take the listing, do it cost a lot of money? Do they want you to spend thousands upon thousands of dollars to market their home? Or like my strategy is when I list a property, I'm marketed to the top 20 or 50 selling agents in the area because I know once I get a listing on the market, they're going, hey, William, you know, I saw your property. When can I show it? Is that sort of strategy you use, or do you also have to cater to their whims and put it in paper or some kind of way how you advertise?
Well, you know, part of being the best agent you can be, not only for yourself and for your family, is being able to have the most productivity, highest rate of return for your clients, but also keep yourself in business. So I just look right. at things a little differently. So part of my thing is like I can spend a lot of money on the listing that may or may not pan out to spend that kind of money, but then what I'm really doing is taking money away from my ability to give myself more systems and more tools to sell more properties. So
right.
I think that one of the biggest things people see the Bravo shows and the $1 million listings, which don't get me wrong, when I first watched Got Real Estate, I was like, I told my wife, I'm going to do that. And she was like, okay, sure, great. And I said, no, I swear, I'm really going to do that. I could do that too. And people think that, okay, they got this really big listing, so he's going to spend, you know, if it's $20 million, it's $50 million worth of advertising. If it's $5 million, it's probably $15,000 in advertising, or whatever. Right. Where are the buyers coming from? How do you market the property, and how much does that stuff cost? But is it worth it? Well, I think where the biggest cost for real estate agents, and this is why I'm kind of creating a media marketing company with the real estate company, is that I think as a real estate agent, the number one thing that we outsource is all the drone shots, photography, videography, staging, virtual staging. That's where a lot of your expenses come from. You look to your real estate companies and you say, well, what services do you give me? And they go, well, we might have some coaching for you, and we'll give you two copy machines, and maybe there's somebody who does payroll, or I don't know what it is, but they're not going to give you all those services, because the problem is that's a ton of money. So you right. as an agent, you have to start to look at those services for yourself. And that's why I'm creating the media marketing company. But you're being able to, first of all, create content on your house. And that comes in the forms of blogs, websites, drone shots, videography, photography, 3D matter reports. Why are you doing all that? Is it worth it? Well, there are certain houses that you can put them on, you know, always do professional photography, but you can put certain houses on the multiple listing service, and you know that in that price range, you have a tendency, if you can list for the X amount of dollars in that price range, you should be getting an offer within 30 to 60 days, as long as it's put and looks tremendous, and you're putting it on right. the mass marketing websites, Realtor, Trulia, Zillow's, third party sites, and you're also putting it on the multiple listing services. And then you have houses. Now, this is because there's a large market for this. That means the majority of the population, okay, are going to be shopping in that price range and do buy houses all the time. So you have low inventory and a good, you know, good buyer rate. So right. good photos, do what you need to do. Now, the thing is, if you have really high-end clients and you have houses that maybe you have 18 to 21 houses like this that sell an entire year, and there's 50 on the inventory,
right.
so you have a totally different world. So now you have a couple of things and reasons why you would market more. Number one, My ability to take all of this content, like I said, the blogs, the social media posts, the website designs, the videography, the photography, the 3D, the walkthroughs, the Matterports, an event at the house. Well, I'm going to take all of this content and I'm going to start to specifically target it to the people that need to have it, because they can't make it up on a Wednesday. They can't make it up on a weekend. Maybe they're from right. out of the country. Maybe they're an investor. And you have to be able to put it into their hands as if they were there. So when you get a market that's so small and so targeted, what you're actually putting into a listing to take it from this physical place that it's in to a virtual world does cost more money. I have a house that is beautiful, 11 acres in backcountry Greenwich, Connecticut for $4.2 million. And it's gorgeous, has a ton of history on it. It's the ruins. We just finished a great event there this past weekend that we did for the LA Las Vegas shooting as a charity there as well. We
had I saw that on Facebook.
Yeah, it was
great advertising.
The cello player was amazing. Sebastian Garrett from the art that brought the art. Bentley Delmar gave us a room. We catered by my restaurant, and we lit up the whole back. They have ruins in there from the 1800s of the actual part of the old Fort Conyers Farms that was there. Okay, all of that was great, but it's to get the people in for an event that really want to actually be part of seeing that at night, seeing the exposure, and then taking that after that, the post-marketing, the post-production, putting that with the package, and then putting it in the hands of people that have the money and want specifically the target to invest in that kind of thing. Okay, you can...
Right. So,
It's that systems and tools. Now, I have other things that cost money, other systems and tools I can't talk about here that we use.
Right.
Okay. Now, all these things cost money. So depending on how targeted you want to get your clients more money than anybody else could, depends on how small the market is. There might not be a market. So how do you create a market? Mm-hmm. Being able to understand how to create a market, you'll understand where your dollars need to go. And that's where you'll know how much do you actually need to spend. So it's not as simple as like, well, I'm just having a big party, like a $1 million listing for 20 grand. And all of a sudden somebody comes in and offers me cash deal and buys the thing. It could happen, right. but it's not
very seldom.
It's not that simple, especially.
And I assume for it's a case by case basis, a property by property basis on your strategy on how to market that property to get top dollar and get it in front of as much people that's going to be interested in that particular property, correct?
Yeah, it depends on where it is. Again, the location. I mean, I'm in the Northeast. We're 35, 45 minutes from New York City. We have to deal with Westchester. We have Massachusetts. We have New York City. We have New Jersey. We have all these other zip codes. We have different taxes. We have different corporate taxes. And a lot of these people are hedge fund business people. So again, depending on where you are, the price range, there might not be a market, or the perception of the market is maybe that it's slower. So how do you increase the perception? How do you increase value of your property to stand out or do anything like that? So again, on a case-by-case basis, do I need to do a drone shot, 3D walkthrough, Matterport tour, build out contents, websites, and then go literally take that to New York City and then do five presentations for people that can't get out of the city to see it? For a house that's maybe $350,000 that I can put it on multiple listing service and I know price right, having the good marketing, making it look great, that I can get an offer in 2 days? Probably not. So it's about understanding your product, I guess, is the best. Right. You have to understand what you're actually selling.
It's way easier to sell a $500,000 home than a $2 or $3 million property.
Some people in the $500,000 home is like a $5 million property in some areas. So it doesn't matter. It's your buyers shift, the area shifts. As long as you understand that they're to being able to do this, not only be able to know where the contact the people to get listings, be able to know what to say to get a listing presentation, right, and then be able to help a person through the listing presentation so that you can take the listing and then go through your process as a professional to consult them, take them through point A of the listing process to content creation, to mass targeting and prospecting, marketing, to negotiating the deal, to making sure all the financing and the appraisals and the inspections are done, to closing, to post. That whole process, every one of those things, depending on where you are and where you go, might have little changes in it, but at the end of the day, you have to understand it's your job to know the differences between every one of them and know how to perfect every one of those things for you to
have a system in place.
Yeah, you have to be able to understand every one of those and how those change or what you need to do depending on where you are for you to be the best you could be for somebody else. And then doing all that, and if you don't know this stuff, if you don't know what it is or how to do it, you have to learn it for you to get confident in order to be able to go into a $12 million property. Say, you know what? This is $10 million worth of 45,000. This is 45 acres, $10 million land. Okay, we're going to do this. Well, you have to understand where that process starts, you know, because you're going up against some tough competition. So you have to be pretty astute on that.
That's why I tell fellow agents, it's like, I used to run track across country. This Saturday is going to be my 30-year high school reunion.
Nice.
So probably before you was born.
Yeah.
So, but I used to run track across country.
I don't know about that. I'm not as young as you think, trust me.
Oh, okay. I thought you were like 29. But when I used to work out, I ran 3 LA marathons, and you had to work out every day. You have to stretch. You have to, eat right. That's the same thing with being a real estate agent. Every morning, you know, to be a proficient real estate agent, get up early, meditate, read, practice your scripts, role play. And the more you do it every day, you get more and more confident. When you're not doing it on a daily basis, you know, you get depressed, you get sad. It's like, oh, you know, should I pick up the phone? No, the more you do it, the more confident you get. And from me talking to you, that's one of the main things as a fearless agent you've done is practice those scripts. You even helped me with my dialogue. And you have a couple books out. Time is running short. So tell us about those books and tell us more about how we can contact you and people have a lot of questions because this is deep right here. You went deep.
So I am This is what I told you, that part of me felt like this was a long time ago, and this has been a crazy avenue because I'm a serial entrepreneur, and I love what I do. And I felt like when I got into this business full time and I left everything else that I was doing and put it all out there, that the chains were kind of off me. And
right.
For some people, they would have been the most scared, which I was, but I felt like I had no more boats, but I had no more parachutes, but I was also the freest. Steve Harvey talks about jump. If you ever heard Steve Harvey talk about jumping, that's kind of like what it's
right.
like. And so
you're more scared before you jump.
Yeah, but you have to jump and you have to make that leap. But so I can tell you that I have so many little projects coming up. I mean, this year in real estate has been crazy. We've just done some stuff and we're continuing to do things. I started LLA, which is my team. I was the luxury lifestyle agent, and we create LLA, which is the leading lifestyle agency. We're also creating a media marketing company. We'll also have another, have my own little.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. Like a podcast / motivational speaking tour kind of thing that we're putting together with this, another Facebook person that most people have heard of. We're also putting together, I opened up a restaurant and nightclub. Brilliant idea.
How's that going for you?
It's crazy. It's crazy. Not bad crazy. It's just, it's different.
Right. It's a different animal.
Yes, you can check out the nightclub and restaurant at vanityct.com.
I'll put the link below.
Sure. I will have, I also have a, I have some eBooks that I put. Prospecting for Freedom is on the luxurylifestyleagent.com. That's already out there. The second eBook, which is about why you say, how you say it, and what you say, you know, on the phone. A little bit more about verbal hypnosis and the science behind it. That's going to be
okay.
And I have one that we're in.
You said that's coming out or already out?
That's I have to just post it. And then the third ebook is about the actual listing presentation. And that one's in final edit mode. And now the idea is that I will be coming out with something in 2018 that is going to be pretty cool, pretty different. I don't really want to talk that much about it, but I'm excited because it's been in the works for almost a year now. Just through all the responses and questions that I've gotten from people, from the Toby Salgado podcast, from stuff like this, and from
right.
the people that I've met and worked with and got to help, that this was some of the things that they were asking me. So I wanted to put a product out there that was something people can purchase. And I think we're kind of finalizing it, putting it together. It's going to be really cool. So yeah, be on the lookout, all that stuff. So if you want to contact me directly, you can call me. It's 203-448-7321. I would probably prefer you just text me or drop me something on Facebook.
I'll put your website link down there, your phone number. Well,
yeah, the luxurylifestyleagent.com. Right. Great way to see my stuff, the houses, the listings that I have. I'll put up my eBooks. Find me on Facebook, YouTube. I have somebody who does a lot of my social media, so I'm not great at it. I should get better at it.
Right.
Now I'll be on there doing this stuff. It's more and more important that you get with people that you really can appreciate what they do, and they same thing with you. And I appreciate you doing this because for a lot of people, they don't know where to start in the game. And, you know, I think finding people to talk to like I did and like you're doing,
right.
help and give
thank
value.
You, thank you.
The biggest thing. So everybody out there too, who, you know, who is questions, you know, real estate and all this stuff, William is a great resource as well. And you should really be talking to him and
thank you. Thank you.
Get a great book out to himself. And yeah, all of the more we can do to help ourselves be better at this profession, I think everybody and everything will get better from it. So,
yeah, because my thing is, it's a lot of people out there that, you know, sings a big song, but they don't put their work, you know, they don't have anything to show for it. And I like to interview people that, hey, they put sweat, tears, and, you know, they put the sweat equity and, you know, hey, they had to go through trials and tribulations. And for me talking to you, you had some real, real trials and tribulations. And now, you know, your business is growing and you're spreading off. You wrote different books. You have a restaurant and a nightclub now, and the Lord is really blessing you. And, you know, hey, kudos to you, because you're doing good and you're giving back. You're helping people. You don't have this big chip on your shoulder. And that's one thing I really like.
No, there's too many people that helped me for me to feel like they have chip on their shoulder. Never lose the edge. I was better on my life. Don't get me wrong. Anybody listening out there, find that thing that kind of motivates you, but consume you to the point where you can't function. But yeah, give back, man. And stuff like this is the best way. And don't get me wrong, it is not all sunshine and rainbows. It is tough every day. But I love it. Like I said, if you don't love it, the grind and the passion, it's too hard. You won't want to keep going, but you better figure out your why and find your passion. And then as far as the other stuff goes, 100%, just keep it going and learn as much as you can and reach out to William, because he's awesome.
Hey, thank you. Before we go, you have any last words to tell all the agents out there that's, you know, looking at the broadcast?
Oh, yeah. I mean, again, like I said, just if you don't know something, be one of those people that tries to figure out what the answer to it is. And sometimes finding mentors, reaching out to somebody is the best way to do it. And I truly believe that. And I tell my son this, I was told this when I was a little young, and I will always stand by this, is that you can do anything you want if you are willing to work as hard as you possibly can. And it doesn't just mean how many hours you put in, because that's important, but also mean as hard as you can on your knowledge and learning, and be the best you can be. Don't be one of these people that pulls people down. Pick people up. So,
absolutely. Well said, good sir. Well said.
Same to you.
All right. Well, hey, this is William May with Michael Ferraro. And hey, if you like what you see, leave a comment below and let everyone know that Michael's the guy to talk to. All right. Y'all take care.
Thank you so much, William. Take care, buddy.